Hello, everyone. Welcome back. These are the Faces of Advocacy Champion interviews, and we have a great one today. Today, we have MP Halland, who is the Shadow Minister for the IRCC, here with us today, and we're going to be talking about a broad range of issues. Remember, here at the Faces of Advocacy, we are not asking for open borders. We are just asking to be together. So first off, welcome. Thank you very much. And right off the bat, why is family reunification important to Canadians and the people of Calgary Forest Lawn?
First and foremost, thank you so much for having me on your open dialogue platform. And again, I just want a huge shout out to all the great advocacy groups, including yourself, that have been doing so much to highlight the importance of family reunification. So a big heartfelt thank you to all of you for all the advocacy work that you are doing. I must also say that keep it up. Sometimes it feels like our voice is not being heard. I promise you, your voices are being heard. So again, a big heartfelt thank you to everyone for raising these issues. It ties into why is it important? And for me, it's more of a, why is it not important? Why do we not want families to be together? We heard heart-wrenching testimonies over and over, and we continue to read them. And we see the impacts that, you know, delayed family reunification is having on people. And it's not just for the people of Calgary Forest Lawn, but all across from coast to coast to coast. It is our job and duty. It is to advocate to make sure that this government is reuniting families because of the burden. We hear stories of missed first birthdays, first words, first steps. I, being a father of two little girls, I know the impact that it has when those things are missed. It's devastating. And, you know, with isolation happening with a lot of different people these days because of the pandemic, there's also a degree of mental health that is taking a huge hit as well. And this is why we need to have families reunited. What we really need to do is look at being more fair and compassionate. Let's clear up the backlogs so that we can help people get back together. That's a message that I appreciate all the advocacy groups are pushing right now.
Yes, there's been a significant backlog, both pre-pandemic, currently during the pandemic, and we wonder in the future how these backlogs can be actually addressed. That's really important. And now, given your current position, congratulations, as the Shadow Minister for the IRCC, what are your current priorities? Where are we going to go next?
Well, I'm the Shadow Minister for Immigration, Refugees, and Citizenships. And first and foremost, I want to take time out to say how grateful and thankful I am to our leader, Honorable Erin O'Toole, for entrusting me with such a big and important role and responsibility, and putting that trust inside of me. And I hope I can do the best I can for everyone from coast to coast to coast, and for the amazing people of Calgary Forest Lawn who elected me into this seat. And I would be remiss if I didn't thank all the amazing support I've received from my supporters, donors, just people reaching out. I really appreciate all that. It gives me more strength and energy to move forward. What are some of the priorities? Priorities are number one, it is our job as the official opposition to make sure that we're holding the government to account. And, you know, our party, the Conservative Party, always wants to take a Team Canada approach, whether it came to the vaccines, whether it came to the pandemic response. We need to be taking a Team Canada approach that is very compassionate and that is fair, just like what we want in our immigration system. Some of the things that come top of mind, of course, are the backlogs. And this ties in with family reunification. It also ties in with a lot of other programs, such as, you know, the grannies and or the grandparents and parents sponsorships. Also some of the delaying time, the wait times and the delayed processing times all across the board. What we want to see is a better streamlined system that helps everyone. That should be one of our main priorities, because coming out of the pandemic, we know that there's going to be a huge, with the numbers and targets that this government has set, we need to prioritize making sure that we have our system is going to be able to handle all of this. I'm also trying to push for a lot of people that are, one thing that I'm passionate about is we used to call group of people, we used to call them low skill. And in my eyes, and I think we talked about this before, is about every work has dignity, every work should deserve honor. And to call someone low skill, I don't think we're giving them that respect that they deserve. We saw people in, and you know, they changed the name to low wage, and good positive step. And you know, the people that are in that category, we saw throughout this entire pandemic, whether it was people in transportation, people in meat processing plant workers, we saw people that were working in healthcare, how really essential their jobs are. And it was the truck drivers who were in the pandemic, who we didn't even know what coronavirus fully was. There was no, there was no hope for a vaccine at that time, yet they were risking their lives, going coast to coast, delivering life-saving supplies for people. And they did it because, those things were desperately needed. Like PPE was needed to be transported all the way across. The same people were not able to go through the drive-throughs on those routes. Same people were not able to use washrooms because they were closed on route. Yet those truck drivers that we consider, you know, low skill before, low wage, look at the essential services they provided, the workers in healthcare, the workers that were in the meat processing plants to keep our supply chains running. My request in the meetings was multiple times to give them a better pathway to PR, because they are already contributing to Canada. They're contributing to our economy. And most importantly, they're already halfway processed. So the processing time would use less of our resources, so we can focus on things like family reunification and use resources towards there. So I hope that the government listens to these things, and I hope they implement them, because again, today's topic, we are talking about family reunification, and it would, those type of solutions that us as a party are putting forward for the Liberal government, we're hoping that it'll help free up resources so we can reunite families better and faster.
Well said. The challenge with those people in that demographic, they were so disproportionately and heavily affected by the COVID burden. There should be some level of protection and, as you say, honor and dignity given in that direction. So with people coming in, irrespective now of their status, people are coming in and now required to go into mandatory hotel quarantines. And I know there's a lot to be said. Could you elaborate on what the current issues are with the mandatory hotel quarantines and how can they be resolved safely?
Absolutely. And this is a absolute great question. And it's been, you know, all of our inboxes are filled with questions like this all across the board. And that doesn't just narrow it down to one party. I know every MP is getting these questions. I want to give a shout out to our health critic, the Honorable, you know, Michelle Rempel, who's from our team, for doing such a great job so far in highlighting these things and asking the right questions. And I want to also highlight our team that's on the health committee for making sure we're finding out answers that Canadians are asking, just like the ones that you ask now. First and foremost, like my colleague had brought up, was what is the data behind how did we get to the decision to have these hotels implemented? So, you know, putting the, and we'll talk about the struggles of the, and the what's happening inside those hotels, but just on a, you know, we need to ask these questions, like what data was behind having these opened up in the first place? Is it safer than someone who has, suppose, a basement that is completely empty in their home, where they can also quarantine if there's other people that they live with, that also has a separate kitchen, in most cases, a separate bathroom, that they're able to even get, you know, their own food delivered to their door? You know, what are the statistics that led them to this decision? Number one question. And we still have not got the answer for that one. Now, when we look at what happens inside those hotels, and we're starting to see more and more videos and more testimonies of just what I would say is not even just unconstitutional, it's un-Canadian, some of the decisions that were made behind this, because we hear over and over again that, you know, it's people's civil liberties that feel that they're being entrenched upon by these things. And then when you look at the actual hotels themselves, like the food that's given, the type of treatment that's going on in there, and then on top of that, the just horrific stories of sexual abuse, the allegations, and just some of the videos of people being able to open doors of some of the people that are living there, it's unconscionable. Because, you know, I am a father to two daughters myself, and I could only imagine having them, like the fear I would have while they're inside that hotel. our party, the Conservative Party, is calling for a suspension of this program. We are always on board when it comes to keeping Canadians safe, especially during this pandemic. That should be our number one role. But we should also be making sure that we're doing things that are science or facts-based and things that are making sense and still keeping Canadians safe. So we are asking for them to suspend this program and actually come out with something that is more safer for Canadians than what we have now. It does highlight the failure of this government. I will say that, because first of all, it was an announcement made with no plan. As usual, we see that over and over again. The hotline to call for just the reservation system, it is unbelievable that people are sitting overseas and in some cases waiting 8 hours, 10 hours on the phone. And at the end of that wait, they get hung up on. Sometimes people have their tickets booked to Vancouver, but Vancouver doesn't have enough space. They have to fly somewhere else. It's just, you know, it's easy to throw out announcements, but you have to have a plan. And who is it? Who's suffering? It's the taxpayer. It is Canadians who are suffering from these decisions. And we are still not clear fully on the exemptions of people that, you know, people that are exempt. And we wish they were more clear on this stuff. It's just another thing where it's easy to make an announcement without a plan. And we're very, very disappointed in that. I hope they fix this very soon.
There are many concerns, and we are grateful for your advocacy, as well as the Honorable Michelle Rempel, for pushing forward.
And the Health Committee members.
And the Health Committee members, your public safety as well. The Faces of Advocacy have taken political, public, and legal means in order to address these concerns. Anyone watching, please know that we're all trying to do our best to protect Canadians and do so safely. So, MP Hallin, why do you feel that the government of Canada has been reluctant to declare family reunification as essential, or has not yet exempted families from the mandatory hotel quarantines? What do you believe is the pushback?
You know, that's something we're trying to get answers for as well. And where we've been asking, you know, like you said, through Public Safety Committee, we're asking this through our Health Committee. And, you know, we have been raising this in the House of Commons as well. We're looking for the same answers, but I can assure everyone that we are still going to push to get those answers. Sometimes, like, you know, there is talk of an election that might possibly, they might spring up. And the thing is that it would be very unfair if they are doing this for, you know, for that upcoming election, if they're making the announcements that they are. For instance, like the 27,000 express entry number that they bolstered just out of the blue. You know, we need to have good immigration track. I'm just giving an example of what just out of the blue that, you know, we made that announcement, but we don't have any real information about that beyond, you know, they've reduced the credit score for people that need to obtain in order to be a part of that express entry. But there's so many other questions that are around that. And I'm just personally, and, you know, we're hoping that it's not something that they're doing as a ploy for an election. We hope that these decisions are being made based on what is the best outcome for Canadians. We want to have Canadian safety at top of priority. We want to see a betterment of Canada approach all the time. And that's what our hope that's what we wish for through this. And we will continue to ask those questions. We'll continue to try to get these answers for everyone.
I've seen that you've done so much work to help reunite families and have been a strong advocate. I'm wondering, for the new users who have not met you before, please tell them how you've been fighting to help keep Canadians safely together during this time.
Absolutely, and I appreciate that. I'm an immigrant of this amazing country. And, you know, when I hear some of the testimonies, I can feel, like, from my own experience, how hard it is and how hard it must be for people to be away from their loved ones. And why is that important? I feel that those, you know, when we're reuniting families, we're creating a healthier, happier Canada. If people can help, you know, come here, build a new life for themselves, what more could someone want? I know from my own personal experience, people I've dealt with, being a small business owner myself, that immigrants bring an entrepreneurial spirit that helps create jobs for Canadians. And that is a beautiful part because of that spirit. And what better way than to unite families together, And just that, just the first, that that happiness that that brings, and then you build up your life from there. You know, people start contributing to Canada. We should be making sure that we're making that one of our main points, that we should be helping families reunite. So ways that we're doing that are obviously through our offices, with cases that come from our own constituents. We are making sure that, you know, documents aren't missing if they are. We're able to help navigate if people have questions. Those are some of the ways. And on a bigger scale, in my role as a shadow critic or shadow minister, it's to keep asking questions in the House of Commons, making sure inside the committee we're asking the questions that are, you know, with examples of how much hardships people are having because of the delayed processing of these applications. So these are different ways, and you know, we do have other means that we're working on, so such as, you know, getting data from the government. It takes some time, but it's a helping guide for us to see what kind of impact COVID actually had on family reunification, and factoring the real life consequences of keeping families apart, which in some cases is really heartbreaking.
To those who have not met MP Howland until today, he has been a support for us well before his current role, and has been there pushing for safe family reunification for quite some time, particularly during the COVID-19 pandemic. So we thank you for that. So the last question is an open-ended one. What message do you have for Canadians who feel lost and forgotten during this very difficult time without their families?
You know, it goes without saying that first and foremost, we need to make sure that we're keeping an eye on our health, and we're following the guidelines that are laid out by the government or not, and by the health officials. That's the most important part, that we are making sure that we help tackle this virus. That first and foremost. Along with that, what I always recommend, and it's something I've done in my daily practice, is making sure that we're reaching out to one another. And if, you know, we have a concept in my faith called seva, and what that means is, you know, selfless service to giving back. And that doesn't always necessarily mean that it's in the form of money. It can be in the form of energy, time. It can be for even if you take a time to do a prayer for someone else. My point is that we should try to reach out to as many people as we can during the day to find out how they're doing. Sometimes we are, you know, going through something in our own lives, but then when we call someone, we hear what they're going through, and it takes away some of our own pain because we're trying to help someone with their pain. And in my daily practice, what I try to do is call three people. I normally just three random people from my phone. I'll have it set up in the morning where I just make it, whether it's an old friend or someone I haven't touched with in a while. Because sometimes it's until we reach out to someone, we don't really know what they're going through, because they won't just, some people are really afraid to reach out. With isolations happening, there's a lot of mental health issues that are on the rise. So my humble request is to everyone, reach out. And sometimes you find out people are having food insecurities. So, you know, when you find that out, you know, dropping off food at someone's door, or a senior, especially reaching out to a senior and the most vulnerable, they need it the most. And you know what? It helps us get through those tough times. It helps us remember what we are. We have a mission in life, and you know, along the way, we should be helping as many people as we can along that mission. Those are my biggest. I don't like to be overly political in these kind of interviews or partisan, but we're in a very critical time where it's not about a party or about anything. It's about working together and making sure that everyone is okay right now. And I hope everyone will, you know, take my humble request and follow through with it, because, you know, honestly, I've seen it in my own life. You could be having a really bad day, but when you reach out to someone and you hear about some of the stuff they're going through, it helps put things into perspective that what the overall mission of our life should be, which means, you know, helping as many people as we can.
Those are fantastic points, to care for one another, because many people are suffering. I'm so glad that you reminded us all of that. For those of you who feel lost, disenfranchised, and forgotten by the current government policies, join us in the campaign at facesofadvocacy.com. You can find us on YouTube, LinkedIn, Instagram, Facebook, and all the social media, as well as Twitter, at Faces of Advocacy. We are not asking for open borders. We are just asking to be together. Please reunite responsibly. Follow public health guidelines. Wash your hands. Wear your mask. do not break the rules, even if you disagree with them. And we will move forward and protect Canadians, both our families and all Canadian families moving forward. We thank MP Hallin of Calgary Forest Lawn, and we'll say goodbye in 3, 2, 1.